Welcome to another edition of the MMA Insiders Podcast with Sam Caplan. I am Jason Floyd, and the past couple episodes, Sam has hit me up about doing a show. Well, this time it was me hitting Sam up. I said, hey, we've got a big Bellator fight, a historical Bellator fight coming up on Saturday night between Michael Chandler and Patricio Pitbull. And I said, hey, man, would you be willing to do a show, just kind of talk about the history of these two guys? And there may not be a better person to turn to than yourself, who, you know, early on in their days in Bellator, I mean, you go back to 2010. These are when these guys made their Bellator debuts. And, you know, there's been times for both fighters where people have kind of wondered, hey, could they go to the UFC? Chandler's had two opportunities of note recently, and ultimately he stayed in Bellator. Patricio Pitbull recently got a new contract with Bellator, so he's not going anywhere. But historically, this is, I mean, you can't write the history of Bellator, Sam, without these two guys' name.
It's a testament to who they are as people. Very loyal, and they've been very smart with their careers. You know, part of me would have loved to have seen both of them end up in the UFC, not so they could fight in the UFC and fight in the octagon, but so that we could have seen some of those fights against some of the talents the UFC has on their roster. But I've always respected them for having the foresight to give Bellator a shot to retain their services. And, you know, you look at the Ben Hendersons, you look at the Matt Mitrione's, you look at the Ryan Baders, all of these guys that have left the UFC and they get these big money deals, and they deserve them, no doubt. But anytime they see Mike Chandler or Patricio Pitbull, they should thank them, because without fighters like Patricio and Chandler, the contributions they've made in building the brand of Bellator, I mean, they're synonymous with the brand of Bellator, and without them and fighters like them, some of the signature guys that have been there since almost day one, and if not day one, you know, season two, season three, these guys that have stuck it out, they didn't get caught up in the hype and buy into just, you know, I'm going to fight for these initials. They always gave Bellator the chance to compensate them properly for their services. Without that sense of loyalty and that contribution to the sport, we may not have a second legitimate home for fighters to go to at this stage. You know, Bellator without these guys, who knows what would have happened? Who knows where the promotion would be right now, or if it would exist? And without a Bellator right now, you look at the Ryan Baders, you look at the Ben Hendersons, you look at a lot of these guys that have left the UFC, Rory McDonald, these guys that have left for quote-unquote greener pastures, there would be no other pasture outside of the UFC if it wasn't for guys like Patricio and Mike building up Bellator.
Yeah, I mean, you go back to season two when Patricio made his Bellator debut, which was Bellator 15, the opening round of the season two featherweight tournament. It was a couple months later, you know, where Michael Chandler made his Bellator debut. And of course, we all know what ultimately happened getting in that lightweight tournament of where he went from there. You know, one of the things that I kind of want to start off with was kind of, for me, if I had to sum up one word for each fighter, for Patricio Pitbull, it'd be passionate. Anyone who's ever talked to Patricio, Patricio's team through a translator, that's one thing I think is about the best word to describe. Maybe the Pitbull brother brand is passion, because there is passion with those guys. When it comes for Michael Chandler, for me, from a reporter aspect, insightful. Every time that I've had a chance to interview Michael, you kind of find something new about him, and he elaborates so much on his answers, no matter what the question is. So I don't know if there's some words that would describe those fighters to you like the way they described me.
I couldn't, you know, to put those guys into one word would be very difficult. Just my impressions of them, you know, overall as people. You know, Patricio, definitely passionate, sometimes a little emotional at times, very animated and also a showman. And, you know, it's funny when you talk about, you know, him communicating through a translator. Sometimes you don't need a translator because, you know, I'm half Italian, you know, half my family, they talk with their hands, they're animated, they're moving around. Patricio, Brazilian, but might as well be Italian. I mean, you see it, you know, if you ask him a question or if he sees something, you see his eyes light up, you see his, you know, his mannerisms, his body language, you know, he gets very excited. And that passion is infectious. I mean, he was always passionate about fighting for Bellator. It was very cool whenever we got to the event site, and either, you know, I would arrive after him or arrive, you know, before him. But whenever he came in, he was always smiles, full of energy, made it a point to go around and say hello to everybody, whether it was, you know, the announcers, Sean and Jimmy, whether it was the crew, you know, backstage, you know, Dean, Mike and Ryan Congleton. You know, whether it was the camera people, the production people, you know, both of the brothers, Patricio and Patrici, always acted like they were the happiest guys in the world to see you, no matter who you were. And they, you know, I think everyone, you know, from to a man to a woman, everyone on that staff loved being around those guys and working with those guys. For Mike, the thing that really stands out about me, definitely insightful, definitely articulate, but the word I would use is professional. Always carried himself differently than most MMA fighters. A lot of MMA fighters, you know, they're grown adults, but they, you know, a lot of them, you know, not all of them, but a lot of them have, you know, it's almost like their emotional growth was stunted. You know, they may be adults, but a lot of them carry themselves like teenagers. Mike carried himself the same way, you know, a Michael Jordan would, a LeBron James. I mean, always carried himself with, you know, professionally. You know, initially was represented by Tyron Woodley. Tyron's legit. I mean, you talk to anyone that's interacted with Tyron, incredibly professional, incredibly smart. That's a legit guy to surround yourself with. Then when Mike stopped being represented by Tyron as his manager, he hired Dave Martin. And Dave Martin is a real sports agent. He's a licensed attorney, represented Chad Greenway in the NFL. I think he still represents Udonis Haslam to this day. Represented Mike Miller when Mike Miller was playing. So, you know, Mike found an agent that was representing, you know, NFL and NBA players. You get outside of that initial circle. You look at his family, the people that he brought with him to events. Sometimes people would bring, you know, just goofballs with them. I'm sure you've seen it, Jason, just some of these entourages. And Mike, you know, everyone around him was solid as a person, whether it was his friends that came around, his family. You know, you get to be around, you know, we got to be around his dad a little bit, and you see how his dad carried himself. And it's like, all right, it's no wonder Mike is the way that he is. He was raised the right way. You know, they're just from his family to his representatives to his trainers, Mike has always been careful about who he has chosen to represent him. And he's always, you know, he's always surrounded by great people. And I think that helps a lot with a fighter. I think a lot of people don't. I think they underestimate that. A lot of these fighters, they take these goofballs into their inner circle. They get bad advice. They start hearing the wrong things. And it just they get into incidents outside of the, you know, not having anything to do with the fighter. And it's just a poor reflection of the fighter. And, you know, with Mike, you never got any of that. He just superstar person, and then everyone around him, just nothing but class.
And one of the reasons that I wanted to bring up this topic with you is because of the insight that you can bring in from the recruitment of both fighters to Bellator. Because, I mean, let's go back to 2010. Bellator is not the brand it is today. You know, I mean,
Jason, you don't need to tell me that.
No, I mean, like, I remember when I was starting the MMA report, you know, and I went back to advice that I got, early on in my radio career, where they said, you know, look, you can't be the morning show host, you can't be the midday host, you can't be the afternoon host, you can't be a night host, but you can kind of take what they do and create your own brand. And when I started the MMA report, so this was back in 2012. It was about March, April-ish that I started kind of coming with this concept. And I looked at the MMA industry at that time, and I said, okay, how am I going to create a niche for myself? How am I going to separate myself? And I was doing interviews with Bellator at the time, and I said, you know what, that's my niche. I said, no one out there is doing coverage. Now, obviously, there's a lot of coverage at Bellator now. You know, now that, you know, the brand is what the brand is, but it wasn't. I mean, you go back to 2010, especially, I mean, you're talking about season two. I got to imagine you're calling up managers trying to get them to, you know, fight in a, you know, in a tournament over, you know, 6-9 week period. They're probably looking and going, I don't know, Sam.
It wasn't hard getting fighters to fight for Bellator. It was hard getting the fighters that we wanted to fight for Bellator to fight for Bellator. I mean, I was getting a lot of phone calls. Bjorn was getting all kinds of calls from managers. But, you know, we wanted to, you know, that second season, we really wanted to build, you know, as much of an elite level brand as we could. And we knew that we weren't going to get necessarily the biggest name fighters, but we thought if we worked the margins, used a money ball theory, you know, and really looked under every, you know, stone possible, that we could unearth some gems, some diamonds in the rough. And we certainly did that. Patricio, his journey to Bellator was interesting because, you know, I had a database even before I worked for Bellator. My plan was to become a matchmaker at some point. It wasn't by happenstance. I was working towards that goal, and I would keep a database of prospects, you know, got, you know, the top, you know, young fighters around. And, you know, right after I had started working with Bellator, someone, just an anonymous person who was not supposedly connected to the Pit Bulls, sent me this footage of Patricio. It was a highlight reel, and it was insane. I mean, like flying through the cage, flying into the camera, every type of high-risk strike that you could throw in MMA, he was landing it and knocking people out. And, you know, at that point, you know, I didn't really move on that because when I researched him, looking at some of the people that he had fought, going through Sherdog, you know, some of the records were a little bit dubious. So there was always that question of projection. Then I started talking to a couple people, and they brought his name up independently. I said, you know what, this could be a guy that, you know, even if the projection is big, this is a guy that we could at least bring in and differentiate ourselves and have someone in there that was incredibly exciting. And I remember pitching it to Bjorn, and Bjorn was a little skeptical at first because his big thing was – he was definitely open to signing as many international fighters. The thing with him, though, he's very cost conscious. He did not want us to end up like an IFL, Elite XC, or Affliction. He watched every penny. And he said, Sam, I have no problem paying to bring in fighters from outside the U.S. as long as there's not a near equivalent to them, you know, already in our country that we don't have to spend a ton of money to fly in. So I showed him the footage. He was impressed. But again, it went back to what other people had said. Who is he doing this against? Can he fight elite level, competition? When we put him in the tournament, he's going to be fighting, you know, top level guys. You know, is he going to be able to do it? And you know, I kept pushing. And eventually we got Patricio in. And we were, I was very excited. I said, hey, you know, It was a big deal for us to bring a guy in of his level of talent and his fighting style. I thought this is a guy that we could really build a brand around potentially if he can make the transition to a much higher level competition. Because you have to understand, Jason, he wasn't fighting at the top level of Brazilian competition. And I had Brazilian friends, and I would ask them, you know, I would, you know, bring him up, and they had no idea who he was. He was an unknown guy, and he wasn't just unknown to the United States because he was fighting in Brazil. He was unknown to many Brazilians. He was very much an underground fighter. So we brought him in, and you know, he validated, you know, everyone that went to bat for him. He, you know, they were validated. I think Ivan Canelo, his manager at the time, the late Ivan Canelo, was a guy that really made the push. Once I heard from Ivan directly, that's when we started to move. And you know, we kind of, some of the questions that we had about whether or not that projection could be made, we said, you know what, we're just going to take the risk and we're going to do it.
Yeah, I mean, you look at his run in Bellator, his only losses have either come by decision or, you know, when he had the leg injury against Benson Henderson, which that's a fight that, as we start to kind of talk about how the fight's going to play out, that's a fight that I do want to bring up. But you look at some of the names he beat, you know, early on, you know, Wilson Heist got two wins over Wilson.
And Wilson was my first ever jiu-jitsu instructor, you know. Incredibly talented fighter, incredibly talented jiu-jitsu practitioner, and really worked hard over his striking over the years, and incredibly tough. Not an easy guy to put away, especially when Patricio fought him. Wilson was very young back then. I mean, he's not old now, but he was, you know, that was Wilson in his athletic prime, and Patricio, you know, hurt him.
Yeah, and you look at in that season four tournament that he got in, beats Georgi Karahanyan in the opening round, then beats Daniel Strauss.
And Georgi's tough. Yeah, all tough guys. And guys that were bigger and stronger than him. It's just his heart is just we can get into the fight in a little bit. But the one, you know, I don't want to go into that down that road too soon, but I'm just going to tell you that from an intangible standpoint, you take two guys that are this tough mentally and physically, they're both going to get hurt. I am very excited to see this fight from certain aspects, but you know, having been involved with these guys, You know, I'm a little anxious as well, because if they fight the way, if this fight goes the way that I think, they're going to shave a couple years off of their career from this. This is they're going to be hurting after this, and they're not going to be able to fight for it's going to be about 6 to 9 months before you see these guys back in the cage. That's my prediction.
Yeah, I mean, this is a fight that I think for people who have been following the Bellator brand, you know, since 2010 up to now, this has been a fight I think everyone has wanted to see.
Yeah.
There's been the heat between these two guys. I mean, these two guys, you know, they don't like each other. They definitely want to fight each other. And, you know, beginning of the year, one of my first episodes of this year, the MMA Report podcast, we did this segment called Bold Predictions. And this was one of my bold predictions. I said I really believe that Chandler and Patricio Pitbull is going to happen, just because more of the fact of Bellator's got to make big fights,
right?
And this is a type of fight that you put on a premium product in the zone. And you know, I'm going to talk about my podcast this week. Personally, I think the Bellator card as a premium product is a better product than the UFC product this week. They both have two great fights, but to me, like, you tell me, I can only watch one. No question. It's a Bellator card. And a lot of that is because of Patricio Pitbull and Michael Chandler. So you talk about how getting Patricio Pitbull to Bellator. So what was it like for Michael Chandler getting him to Bellator?
Before we get to Chandler, I want to go back and talk about Patricky if I can. Sorry to kind of get off topic
here,
but you know, they're synonymous with each other. Right after we had signed Patricio, you know, when I was researching Patricio and I would go through the Sherdog Fight Finder, I saw Patricky Pitbull as well. And I thought, you know, because sometimes with Sherdog, things get entered in weird. Any fight finder. And, you know, because it was Brazil and things were being reported from Brazil, I thought they were the same guy. I didn't even know. I didn't even know for a while that there was a brother. And once we realized that, Patricio had already started fighting for us. And I remember running in, you know, seeing Ivan Canelo in the lobby. And I said, hey, you know, I just heard that Patricio has a brother. Why haven't you mentioned him? Let's sign him. And, you know, he got real hush hush and he said, hey, Sam, I don't know if we should talk about this too much, especially not around Patricio. It was a very sensitive subject because Patricky, there was very high hopes for him as a fighter, and at that time he was not fighting the time that I had brought him up because there was injuries, and I think it was a little bit of a sore spot that Patricio was getting this opportunity, and Patricky, you know, at that point, you know, Ivan had said, I don't know if Patricky's going to fight again, and it's a sore subject. Let's not really bring it up. He's not an option right now. And then once Patricio started taking off several months later, I think maybe 6 to 8 months later, Patricky was there. If I remember correctly, he was there, you know, in the lobby, you know, showed up. And Ivan said, hey, Patricky's ready. He wants to fight for you guys. And it was a little bit of a process getting Patricio in. And, you know, I remember talking to Bjorn, you know, it was quite a contrast because he was such a believer in Patricio at that point. I said, hey, Patricio's brother, Patricky, remember that guy I was telling you about? He wants to fight for us now. And Bjorn's one question was, does he fight like his brother? And I was like, yes, he does. He goes, sign him. And it was done within a couple of days. I mean, we had a contract generated. We sent it out. And, you know, Ivan was adamant. He said, Patricky wants to fight for you guys. He does not want to fight for anyone else. And, you know, he made it sound like if we didn't sign Patricky, he wasn't going to come back. So that was very exciting, you know, to have both of those guys. And another story is, I love Sean Wheelock. Sean is the man, but Sean is very proper and particular. And if you listen to the early broadcasts, he would refer to Patricio and Patricky by their given name, given last name. I think it's spelled Freire. Sean pronounced it Freire or something like that. Sean was always great about the actual pronunciation, would pronounce it with the accent, especially with the international names. But I said, Sean, no, we're branding them as the Pitbull brothers. We're trying to make stars here. I understand why you're doing this. I don't want to hear their last name. And Sean was kind of like, well, you know, Sam, I'm going to, you know, do what I, you know, he didn't say it in those exact words, but basically was going to, you know, I'm going to do, you know, the way I think it, you know, is a justice to them. But Bjorn made the call. Bjorn's like, no. He told everyone in production, you will not use their last name for any graphic, and you know, referring to them for – they are Pitbulls. It's Patricio Pitbull. It's Patricky Pitbull. And, I think Sean was worried that they might feel disrespected, that we were basically taking liberties and giving them a new last name. But it was their nickname, And if you look at it, they branded themselves Pitbull brothers. I mean, they've got the tattoos and everything. So I think it worked out for everyone involved. Now, going on to Mike and the recruitment process, at the time, I was working for Showtime basically as a production assistant slash researcher and technical analyst. I would work with their announce teams and certain people on production when it came to scripts and getting production notes ready and just advising them on certain things every now and then because they had such a rich boxing background. MMA was a little new to them. And, you know, first started doing it when I was with, when they were with Elite XC. Then this changeover was made to Strikeforce. And, you know, I remember being, you know, I saw both of Mike's Strikeforce fights. I was actually in the building for both of them. I think the first one was in Kansas City. It was at Memorial Hall. My buddy Joe Kelly, it was his arena at the time. He owned that arena. And, you know, I wasn't working that show. I didn't work Strikeforce Challengers. It was Show XC became Strikeforce Challengers. I didn't work those shows. I provided the notes, but they didn't fly me out. They flew me out for the big championship shows. But you know, I had miles left over, and you know, it was Joe's arena. You know, he wasn't the promoter, but you know, it was his arena. So I said, you know what, I'm going to fly out and just hang out with Joe and hang out with the Strikeforce, the Showtime crew, because they're all my buddies, and you know. So I was like, I'll go down there. It'd be a lot of friendly faces, and I'll just watch some MMA. And I remember being in the crowd, and there was a buzz about Mike Chandler. I had never heard of him prior to that. There was a buzz in the crowd. You know, people next to me, people behind me said, "Oh, this is Tyron's guy. This is Tyron Woodley's guy." And I was like, "What are you talking about?" And they said, you know, basically they said this was Tyron. You know, Tyron was bringing this guy along. It was his protege. They had wrestled, at Mizzou. They were buddies. You know, and someone said, "This is the next. Watch this guy. He's the next big thing in MMA." And he came out. He was fighting at welterweight. His first two fights for Strikeforce were at 170. And that fight in Kansas City, I believe, was only his second ever professional fight.
Correct.
And just dominated. And then I remember, I think his next fight that I saw was in St. Louis for a big Strikeforce show out there. He was on the undercard once again. And, you know, I was still working, you know, just production guy doing 5 ounces of pain. But I took notes and, you know, I put them in my database. And I remembered that name. Months later, I'm working for Bellator, and I get a call from Tyron Woodley. And I think it was the first time I'd ever spoken to Tyron or communicated with him. He's like, "Hey, I've got a guy that I think you guys might be interested. His name's Mike Chandler." I'm like, "Well, I know who that is." But wait a minute, Tyron. He's with Strikeforce. We can't talk to him. I can't have this conversation with you. It's illegal. And he goes, no. He's not under contract. He goes, we haven't signed with anybody else because we're waiting for a contract with Strikeforce. It hasn't happened. You know, and he was very cautious. He goes, "Sam, that's our preference is to sign with them. They gave him the fights. We want to work with them. They can come back into the picture at any time. Just want to make you aware of that." And it was interesting that he was on one fight deals because Strikeforce was not in a position that we were in. I mean, we had our own TV deal. I mean, it was Fox Sports Net. We could do whatever we wanted, just about whatever we wanted. And we had all these fight slots. You know, we had, you know, if someone was good and they were exciting and they had potential, and they wanted to fight a lot, we could give them just about as many fights as they wanted. And I think Strikeforce was a little hamstrung in their situation. I mean, they were in a vastly different situation than Bellator. They had the Showtime deal, which was an awesome deal, but their main shows, Showtime had approval over all of the shows. And understandably so. You know, it's a situation where they're in the premium subscription business. They were paying more than a fair rate to Strikeforce. You look at some of the networks out there in the history of MMA, and they have been less than a supportive partner to growing the sport of MMA and the promotions that they worked with. You know, a lot of barter deals, a lot of time buys, you know, but Strikeforce wasn't doing that. I mean, Showtime wasn't doing that. They were paying real money to Strikeforce. So you would expect them to say, "Hey, these are our airwaves. We're paying good money. We want to have oversight." So in being in that situation, you know, Strikeforce was under the gun to sign, you know, premium level fighters. And they were, having to outbid the UFC to retain their own talent and bring talent in. And they didn't have a lot of financial flexibility. So when they had their Strikeforce Challenger shows, you know, they, a lot of the guys were people that could drive in. And their undercards for their championship shows were guys that could drive in. They didn't have the airfare, and they didn't have the televised flight slot, televised fight slots. They couldn't take a prospect like Michael Chandler necessarily and say, hey, Mike, this is your second fight. We're throwing you on the airwaves. It was a different makeup, a different situation that we were in. So we had the advantage in that we had a lot of TV fight slots to fill. And we could take a guy like Mike Chandler and say, hey, how many times do you want to fight? You can fight as much as you want. And that's basically how it went. You know, we went to Tyron and we went to Mike and we said, you know, how often does Mike want to fight? And Tyron's basically like, you know, probably once a month. You know, we want to, you know, he's young, he's hungry, he wants to make some money. He doesn't want to go off and get a job and have to kind of do this on the side. He wants to focus on being a full-time fighter. And we're looking for a situation that can allow that. And I just don't, I'm not saying that Strikeforce obviously realized his talent. They just couldn't accommodate what Mike was looking for at that time, and we could. And the negotiations dragged out for about 6 to 8 months. I mean, Tyron and I were talking for a while, and then Dave Martin stepped in, which was kind of a surprise. And you know, the financial demands for us were very they were pretty steep. You know, looking back on it, it was a bargain. You know, Mike was worth a lot more than we paid him. But for us, with the way our financial structure was, you know, for a guy that only had, you know, three total fights, we couldn't put him right into a tournament. We had to get him more fights so that when we went to commissions and proposed him in bouts, he had enough of a record. So, you know, and there was a signing bonus involved. And Bjorn was very hesitant about signing bonuses. And I think that dated back to the fact that, you know, he worked with Lee Steinberg, very closely with Lee Steinberg, and worked with athletes from the NFL. And I think he saw what could happen with signing bonuses. Guys could get a big head, you know, get that money, get a big head, and they stop working. Or guys continued to work, but maybe the projection or the evaluation was a little bit off, and now you've committed all this money and you don't get that money back. Yeah. So Bjorn was always very cautious about that. There was definitely a struggle getting the money right where we needed to get. And I don't want to say I butted heads with Bjorn on that, but there was always a push that I, you know, it was like he was, Bjorn being a lawyer, I had to make that case. You know, yeah. Bjorn was always open to differing opinions, but you had to present it to him like a lawyer. You had to make your case, and we had to make that case, and the demands kept going up. And Bjorn basically said, you know, finally he's like, you know what, Sam, all right, I'm going to do this. I don't know why it's taken us, you know, 6 to 8 months, why we've invested this much time into this guy, but I'm going to give you the money. We're going to do it. But, you know, this guy better deliver. If not, you know, you're going to be held accountable for it. You know, and that's paraphrasing. That wasn't the exact quote. But, you know, he made it clear that there's a lot riding on this. You know, this better work out, because it was out of his comfort zone in terms of what he wanted to spend. And really in terms of how long the negotiations went. You know, Bjorn wanted to work with fighters that wanted to fight for us. And if negotiations dragged on, Bjorn would, you know, he wouldn't hesitate to cut in and say, stop talking to this guy. He doesn't want to fight for us. If he doesn't want to fight for us, it doesn't work. And I said, no, this isn't the case. Mike is open to fighting for us, but, you know, he's got Strikeforce also interested in him. This is what they need to do before they commit to us 100%.
And talking about the quick turnaround that he had in those first two fights in Bellator, he fought Bellator 31 on September 30th, 2010, and then comes back 2 weeks later at Bellator 32.
He's a beast. He was a beast. He would have fought once a week if we allowed him to.
And of course, I know you've talked about this story, and it's got to be one of the most memorable fights with Michael Chandler, is actually his, you know, lightweight tournament quarterfinal matchup against Marcin Hell, because potentially he could have been out of the tournament even with the win due to injury.
Yeah, I've told this story before. Let's tell it again. We had a lot invested in Mike, and we don't root for fighters per se. You make the best fights that you can, but you know what you've got invested in someone and what the potential payoff is. That's always in the back of your mind when you're a promoter or a matchmaker. But I remember seeing him get caught. I don't remember if it was a knee bar or a heel hook, but it was, you know, that was Marcin's bread and butter. He wasn't, and once he caught you in that, it wasn't a half-assed attempt. He was very technical with that. Once you were in it, it was fully applied and was applied the right way. And through sheer will and determination, Mike refused to tap. It was full on locked in. You know, you could see the knee tearing, you know, you could see it. And I remember walking back, you know, I knew it. I remember the fight was over. Mike had won. I remember seeing Mike walking back to the locker room and he was in pain. And I was freaked out. I was still very early in my career, you know, at that point as a matchmaker. And I was just like, Mike, are you okay? You know, I was very worried about it, him, and I showed that emotion. And Mike was worried about the commission being around. And he's basically like, Sam, shut up. Like, just shut up. Like, you know, get away from me. Because he didn't want to get hit with a medical suspension. He was going to do everything that he could to continue in that tournament. If that meant hiding the knee injury from the commission, he was going to do that. And he didn't want me around him to blow his cover. And I remember the Alvarez fight, the culmination of that tournament, you know, Michael winning, going on to fight Ed Alvarez in, you know, for the title. And I don't know if it was a new injury, but I felt it was the same injury. At one point, I remember watching that fight from our vantage point, seeing a knee buckle and Mike kind of limp around. I think maybe it was round two, like halfway through round two. And I thought, and I would love to ask Mike if that was the same injury, was that the same injury? And I remember seeing Mike kind of slow down, hobble around a little bit in the cage. And at that point, I thought Mike was done. I just said, oh, this is it. You know, Ed's going to press him and that's going to be it. You know, and they went back to their corners and I said, this is going to be, I think this is the beginning of the end. And I didn't see the limp. Mike came out for the next round, was pretty much fine and pressed the action right back. So just incredibly durable, incredibly tough. The intangible factor that is there, and you talk about gameness and just his level of competition. Anyone that gets in his way, he's not gonna let him stop him.
You know, in terms of memorable fights on the other side for Patricio Pitbull, there's a couple of fights that stick out to me. I think one of those fights has got to be Bellator 85, the Bellator debut on Spike TV. It's him versus Curran for the title. It was the opening fight. It's like, hey, we're going to kick off this new era of Bellator with the bang. So that's one that sticks up to me. The win at Bellator 132 against Daniel Strauss, where he gets a submission late. And then the other one that really jumps out to me is the Daniel Vigil fight, where he nearly gets finished in the opening round. And, I mean, literally may have been 5 seconds away from losing that fight for the referee coming and stop the fight. Then he comes back in the next round and knocks out Daniel. For you, what are the kind of memorable fights for you for him?
The Joe Warren fights. I mean, just that whole Joe Warren situation. I actually got to go back now and look. It's been so long, Jason. I got to bring it up on Fight Finder to kind of refresh my memory. You know, the Bellator, you know, the 23 fight, you know, the split decision fight, I believe that was in Louisville. You know, I remember just the heat between those guys. And, you know, I love both of those guys. So fun to be around. And just, you know, they were all in on that kind of, it was almost like a pro wrestling feud. It was straight out of pro wrestling. It was real, but not to the point where we ever felt it was going to cross a line behind the scenes. And I remember Patricio, you know, still didn't speak great English, but he told everyone. I remember it was Joe Kelly and I think we were talking to him in the lobby, just, you know, broken English. And he told, you know, and he was telling other people too that, you know, he promised a Brazilian surprise, you know, and we were like, what's this Brazilian surprise that he's talking about? And he hit a takedown on Joe Warren. I mean, he worked his wrestling during his camp. And that was one of the things that stood out about Patricio as a fighter. Certain guys, you'd say, hey, they're weak in this and they're going to work on this in their camp. And then they just never were able to apply it in a high level fight situation. Patricio, he could take something that he wasn't necessarily strong in, work it and work it very well, something that was out of his comfort zone. And you could start to see it actually applied in a real life situation in an effective way. And I just remember the animosity between those guys, and Patricio always wanted the rematch. I think that split decision still bothers him to this day. He's always wanted that rematch. And I remember any time, you know, Joe Warren would lose an opponent, there would be an email, you know, or a text message saying, "Hey, Patricio, he'll take the fight. He'll step in." I mean, it could have been on 3 days' notice, 24 hours' notice, any opportunity to fight Joe Warren, Patricio would have done it. You know, it was all, we were always getting those calls and texts and emails. "Hey, we heard you lost a fight. Joe needs a new opponent. We'll do it."
That's Patricio Pitbull for you. That's him and his brother, man. They are, you know, they're ready to go at any moment. I mean, it's, you know, and I think what's hurt Patricio over the last year or so is the fact of the Vichel fight, which is a split decision, very close fight. Close fight against Emmanuel Sanchez. And so I think that's hurt his stock a little bit here, but now this is really his opportunity. And you go back, I know a lot of people are going to say, "Oh, there's going to be a huge size difference." And yeah, it's going to look like a 55er fighting a 35er. Yeah. I mean, that's what it's going to look like. Yep. But I will tell people, go back to that Benson Henderson fight. Patricio was having success early on in that fight.
Before, he was winning the fight. He was winning the fight until the leg, until he had the leg injury. So,
you know, and you look at Michael Chandler. I mean, look, we all think about that run he had, but there was that time where, you know, he'd lose a race or close split decision against Eddie Alvarez. Then another close split decision against Will Brooks. I remember being there. It comes down to that fifth round, that fight. Then, of course, he gets knocked out by Will Brooks just later on in that year. And that came up in the shoulder programming on DAZN, which is now on DAZN YouTube channel, where they did like that. They called it Bellator 221 face-off. If you're familiar with how HBO did their face-off with two boxers, one announcer, that's essentially what it was. And one part of the two things that really stuck out to me, A, they talked about why this fight did not take place last year. When Brent Primus pulled out of his fight against Michael Chandler due to an injury, Chandler signs a contract to fight Patricio, but Patricio wanted it to be five rounds, not three rounds, so ultimately that's why it did not happen. But, you know, they also talked about this quitting in fights. And, you know, Chandler brings up the Joe Warren fight. And, of course, Patricio brings up the second Will Brooks fight where Michael Chandler says, "Hey, look, I was unconscious." You know, and to me, like, that's, you know, and of course, when Will went to the UFC and did not have the success, right, I thought that hurt Michael Chandler in terms of where he stood as a 155er, you know, throughout MMA. But of course, he's been on a roll. You know, he had the Brent fight, you know, where, you know, he get the injury, you know, loses the title. But, you know, he's come back and, you know, he got that win against Brent back earlier this year. And it's just, to me, this is a fight that's going to be very interesting. And I liked what you brought up a little earlier. This is a fight that potentially could take some years off these guys.
No, it absolutely will. I think the Alvarez-Chandler fights definitely hurt Mike. You know, and it may come back to hurt Eddie. You know, it's, fighter can only be in so many wars. You know, just the injuries, the scar tissue, these injuries, these serious injuries that happen in fights, they linger on for years sometimes. You know, it's not, you know, fighters recover and they get back in training, they get back in the cage, but so the damage lingers on. I mean, the scar tissue is legit. And you know, the trauma to the head and just, you know, to the body, you know, it takes years. It can take years off your life to be, shouldn't say years off your life, years off of your career, fighting life, your fighting career. And, you know, expect, you know, major injuries, expect something, because you look at the intangible factor and you look at both of these guys accusing the other of having quit in fights when they really haven't. That's just fighters talking and looking for an edge any way they can get. There is no quit in these fighters, but they've upped the ante now by making those statements towards each other. Neither one wants to lose to the other. I mean, and you could say, well, gee, Sam, does any fighter want to lose? It's a different level of determination. They're going to find a gear that they didn't necessarily have access to. You know, it's just the sheer grit determination level when it comes to, you know, continuing when they might not be have able to continue in other situations. There's the adrenaline factor is going to kick in more so than it's ever had probably for both of them. The thing, you know, from a fight perspective, Jason, I want to talk about is that, you know, Mike has to be careful. He will have the size advantage. Absolutely. He will be the stronger fighter. But Patricio is so dynamic and so explosive, and he has that killer instinct. If Mike gets caught with something and just shows even a little glimpse of damage, or Patricio is going to see that as daylight, and he's going to make that charge. If Mike is hurt, He's got to suck it up and get out, disengage and get out of the way. Because if he winces, if he doubles over, if he shows any hesitation, Patricio is going to run at him. And Mike's got to – it's got – that voice has to be in his head. Get out – I'm in danger. Get out of this. Get away. Because if he can't communicate with himself to that level and push himself when if he is hurt – Patricio's going to go in for the kill. He's going to try to finish him right then and there. Mike, I think, will be the more methodical of the two. You know, Mike has the wrestling advantage, but Patricio has worked very hard over the years on his defensive wrestling. He watches a lot of footage, is very, you know, his fight IQ is incredibly high. You know, you saw that in the Joe Warren fight, using certain skills that no one thought he had, incorporating that and, using it, the element of surprise against Joe Warren and actually hitting a takedown against one of the best wrestlers, of our time, former Olympic level wrestler. With Mike, I don't think Mike's going to go for the takedown early. I think Mike is going to stand and trade a little bit, try to lull Patricio into thinking that, hey, I'm going to bang it out for the whole time here. If Mike sees an opening, I think he will look to hit the takedown. But if he can't, don't look for Mike to expend a lot of energy trying to bring Patricio down. You know, we saw that against Ed at the Alvarez fight. It turned into a firefight. Mike realized that Ed's defensive wrestling was strong. Ed works on that relentlessly. So there, it's going to be tough to bring Ed down. Patricio, is not going to be the stronger of the two, but again, has that low center of gravity, heavy hips. So Mike might go for it at a certain point, try to use the element of surprise, but you're not going to see him spend a lot of energy trying to take Patricio down if Patricio is able to defend. So I think the vast majority of this fight will be fought on the feet. And I think that, Mike's got to use that reach. Mike's not an emotional fighter. Patricio can be at times. So Mike's got to use Patricio's emotion to his advantage, and maybe throw a fake, an injury, maybe fake, if Patricio hits him with something, maybe, let Patricio believe that Mike's hurt so that Mike can, use Patricio's over-aggressiveness to his advantage.
One of the things, and I just pulled it up here, says we're doing this show here on early Monday evening. Currently, Michael Chandler is -230 on the betting lines. Patricio Pitbull +190. Going to be interesting to kind of see how that line goes. But if you're a Patricio Pitbull bettor, I would tell you wait till Saturday because that's probably good when you're going to get your best number.
Yeah, I think Patricio will be a good value. I don't like making a prediction when two guys that I like this much are fighting each other. There's so many different scenarios in which this fight could unfold. Anything can really happen. If I had to place the bet on the smart money, it would be on Mike. But in terms of value, because of Patrice's dynamic ability and the intangible factor. Mike obviously has that intangible factor, but you're talking about the bigger guy versus the smaller guy. You can't count out the smaller guy in this situation because he has the intangible factor as well. He's so explosive and dynamic. Something could happen out of nowhere. So if I was a bet, I don't necessarily believe in betting, but if I was going to place a bet, I mean, smart money's on Mike, but the best value, it would be on Patricio because something big could happen. Something surprising could happen.
And I think one of the things you have to mention with Patricio, training with Henry Cejudo and how much that's helped his wrestling over the past couple of years. Of course, Michael, who now resides in Nashville but does his training camps down in South Florida at Hard Knocks 365. It's just one of these fights that you just want to sit in front of your television set on Saturday night and just enjoy the fight because if you are a fan of MMA, not just a fan of the UFC, you understand this is a big fight that Bellator is putting on. I mean, you got, MVP and Lehman in the co-main event. I kind of know how that fight's going to go down.
Do you think Lehman's going to bury him?
Oh, yeah. If Paul Daly can take down Michael Page at will, what's Douglas Lehman going to do?
I think Doug may try to knock him out.
I don't know. I think Doug uses – I think, I like Doug to win that fight. I mean, another great fight that's on that fight card is A.J. McKee, Pat Curran. I mean, when you talk about Patricio Pitbull, there's three guys that are always – or two other guys that are always going to be linked to him, and that's Daniel Strauss and Pat Curran. I mean, those three guys are going to be, talked about for years to come just because for a long time that was the Bellator featherweight division.
Yeah, if there was a Mount Rushmore for Bellator fighters, I think Patricio, Chandler, Strauss, and Curran would be that. That's the Mount Rushmore of Bellator. You know, somebody might say, well, what about Eddie Alvarez? You know, it definitely, you know, would get consideration. But, you know, having gone on to fight for multiple other organizations, I mean, these guys fought the vast majority of their careers in Bellator, still fighting in Bellator currently. So
I think when you talk about that Mount Rushmore, they're 155 and under.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that's just, this is not something you necessarily, you know, see in MMA. I don't know how this fight's going to go down. I think that it's going to be really interesting to see how the game plans unfold on Saturday night. How does each one, because to me, this is going to be a chess match of who is going to be able to do that. It wouldn't surprise me the first 5 minutes is a total feeling out process of these guys just trying to figure out what each other's going to do. And then once we hit the second round, that's really when this fight's going to go. Or who knows, maybe Michael Chandler just comes out and he just bull rushes him.
I don't think that's going to happen. I think that you're not going to see Mike spend a lot of energy trying to take Patricio down, and you may not see him spend a lot of energy trying to finish Patricio. You know, Patricio, when you talk about the intangible factor, you know, he's just so dangerous. Mike, you know, if he goes in for the kill and can't finish Patricio and he expends a lot of energy, Patricio is going to counter that. So I think that you're going to see a very methodical fight from Mike Chandler. I think Patricio not as much. I think Patricio is going to try to go for that big finish, where I think Mike, because he's the bigger fighter, might try to grind Patricio out and take it to the later rounds and see what Patricio has left, you know, going five rounds with a bigger fighter, what Patricio has left maybe in the fourth or fifth round. And then, you know, I just have a feeling this is going to go to a decision.
And it should be noted, Chandler's lightweight title is on the line here, which Patricio in that DAZN special, he noted, doesn't care about the belt. This is personal to him. He feels that Chandler has come after his family.
He cares about the belt, too. Championships are a major accomplishment to the pit bulls. So he might be saying that, but he does care about the belt too.
You know, and of course, which if he wins this, then it really makes things very interesting, because Bellator is doing a 16-man featherweight tournament to start later on this year. Obviously, Patricio is going to be a part of that, which then that really clouds up the lightweight division. So if you're a guy like Brent Primus, Benson Henderson, various other fighters at 155 pounds, you're probably rooting for Michael Chandler to win.
Maybe Patricio wins, gives up the title, and they do a 55 Grand Prix.
Yeah, it's, you know, that's the thing. I'll say this with Bellator and the tournaments. I think that they've drawn a little bit of interest, but I think that the problem they've had, and I think you're seeing them looking to correct that with this featherweight tournament, is the amount of time that is taking them. You know, Scott Coker's already come out and said the plan is they're going to do the opening round of that featherweight tournament in one night. So, you know, and I think they see how, with the heavyweight tournament, how it went. You look at this welterweight tournament. So it'll be, you know, they're definitely becoming back to, I guess it's kind of coming full circle, Sam. Bellator's back in the tournament business.
I love tournaments. They're tough to execute from a behind-the-scenes standpoint. They are a pain in the you-know-what, but I think from a viewer perspective, it definitely adds a realistic, traditional sports feel to it. And
this week in MMA is another example of how this sport has gone digital, as we've got PFL making their debut on ESPN Plus this weekend on Thursday. So we got Kayla Harrison in the headliner on that one. Then you got, you know, Bellator on DAZN, and then of course UFC pay-per-view on ESPN Plus. I watched DAZN. I'm a DAZN subscriber. Watched the Canelo fight. You know, stream quality was great. Little odd snafu they had there when Jacobs was trying to come to the ring. They play his music, then it just stops. And then Michael Buffer says something, and then another song comes on, and he comes back out. Yeah, it was weird. I'll say this. I think DAZN's done a great job. And it'll be interesting when we get to Saturday night. What is, you know, when you look at MMA Twitter, what's it like in comparison to Bellator? And the UFC, Jack Swagger, a.k.a., you know, Jake Hager, getting his second pro fight. You know, how can he develop? So Bellator's got a nice card. UFC, to me, the fight that truly gets me that pay-per-view is Jose Aldo, Alexander Volkanovski. The Anderson Silva fight, I don't know, it just doesn't have much interest to me.
Yeah, weird matchup. Thing that we should mention, though, for DAZN, you know, if people are having financial issues or they just don't have the money, remember, you get a free month of DAZN. I believe that's still the case. You get a one-month free trial. If you were ever going to use that free month, this is the fight to do it for, Pitbull versus Chandler. It just it's going to be electric.
Yeah, I mean, look, and obviously they're trying to get as many subscribers as they can.
Yeah.
I'm just on their website to see if they still do that free month. I don't think they do that anymore.
Oh, they don't?
I don't think they do. I mean, for $100 a year, it's a good deal. If you're an MMA and a boxing fan, I mean, I understand if you're an MMA fan and you have a traditional cable subscription, you have Paramount, you know, maybe it's a little bit of a tougher sell, but for $100 a year with the boxing that you're getting, the MMA that you're getting, to me, it's a nice value.
Or pay the 20 bucks for 1 month and then cancel after the show. I mean, the show that they put together, well worth $20.
Yeah, I mean, if you would have got it, you know, last Saturday, you could have got Canelo Jacobs and then this fight for $20. You can't beat that. I mean, but that's the world we now live in, Sam. It was funny, you know, my wife's birthday was yesterday and we're over family and, you know, family's talking about cord cutting and, you know, and it's just, it's really I mean, I've made the switch. I'm a cord cutter. I didn't think I'd ever do it. You know, I've got YouTube TV, but you know, that price keeps going up.
Yeah. They just raised it to $50. I didn't, the Food Network, great programming there, but I could do without it for another $10 a month.
I have food. If I really want to watch Food Network, I have it on the Watch ATT, which I get as a ATT wireless subscriber. But yeah, it's I love the YouTube TV product. I think it's a great product. I've got the unlimited DVR, so you know, yeah. But
I love the fact that it's the only, to my knowledge, you know, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong, the only streaming, you know, live streaming platform that has regional sports networks. For us in Philadelphia, we get Comcast Sportsnet Philadelphia. That's what you have to have if you want to watch the Sixers and the Phillies and the Flyers. It's a lot of these, other packages, these alternatives to traditional cable, you don't get Comcast Sportsnet. You can't get it. It's a weird law because of the way it's wired. Xfinity, Comcast, they don't have to offer it to competing platforms. A lot of the other regional sports networks, they do have to offer it. But for us in Philadelphia, it's one of the only ways where we can get Comcast Sportsnet Philadelphia and get that access to those games without having to actually have Comcast cable.
Yeah, that was, you know, when I was looking to cut the cord, that was my big thing. How do I watch the Lightning, the Rays, the Magic games, and YouTube TV? Boom, it's right there. And as long as you have good internet quality, you know, it's a solid stream. But definitely looking forward to seeing Michael Chandler, Patricio Pitbull on Saturday night. Of course, Sam, as always, always love talking MMA with you. Of course, let everyone know about that Twitter handle if they ever want to hit you up on social media.
Yeah, at Sam Caplan, BAC, Caplan with a C.
And, of course, I am at Jason_Floyd. Of course, coming up this week on the MMA Report podcast, we're going to preview all of Bellator 221, UFC 237. We'll get into my tweet where I talked about how I thought the Bellator card is what I'm going to watch on Saturday night, which got a lot of social media engagement. Had someone from Bellator comment on it, had some other people comment on it. So definitely we'll have that coming up here on Wednesday. So, as always, Sam, appreciate time, and we'll be talking soon, man.
Sounds great. Good talking to you, Jason.